is it important? Why do we need to do the financial statement normalization when we are doing a business valuation?
Since we take the average for some years,
it is not to take the average, because as it is mentioned here, the purpose is to eliminate if there is anomalies or abnormal activities which is reported in the financial account. Because when we are doing a business valuation, normally we will need to do analysis, a comparison in terms of financial statements between the subject companies and the comparable, right? So if we do not normalize the financial statements, so we may end up getting the wrong figure for the values. So normally the main purpose of normalization is to ensure that what is reported in the financial statements are a common items which should be reported by a normal company. If there are some what in financial normalization activities, they call it non-recurring or anomalies. So dia kalau if you look at the financial statement, if you find that there are some which we may not frequently see in a normal company's financial statement, so therefore we need to normalize them. We need to take them out from the company's financial statement. So that is why we need to do financial statement normalization. So for instance, yeah, like if we looking at a partnership or sole proprietorship, so normally if we look at the income statement for a sole proprietorship or a partnership, so normally we will report the salary or wages in the income statement, right? Because the salary or wages is a part of the expenses which will be deducted from the amount of gross profit in order for us to calculate net profit, right? So for sole proprietorship, it is what we can call it. It is a common practice for sole proprietorship, whereby the owners overclaim the salaries. So when the owner overclaim the salary, it will affect the net profit of the company. So if we find out that or if we notice that the owner has overclaimed the salary in the company's income statement, then we need to normalize that income statement. So we need to adjust the salaries according to the standard salaries within the industry or within the market. So that is a simple example for income statement normalization. So that's what it means with non-recurring or anomalies in the financial statement. So that's why it is mentioned here. The purpose is to eliminate anomalies and provide accurate historical information. that enable reliable comparisons and forecasting. So let's say if in your test or in your exam, the question asks you using appropriate example, explain or elaborate the purpose of financial normalization in or for business valuation. So you may use that example lah in order to explain your answer. So normalizing a financial statement involves adjusting. So again, this is still under the definition. So we give you a definition from different sources so that you may get a clearer picture on what is a financial statement normalization is all about. So in this another definition, so it is mentioned here that normalizing a financial statement involves adjusting it so that it reflects only the normal affairs of the company. So that's what I meant when I explained about the salary, which is overclaimed by the sole proprietorship owner in the company's income statement. So we want to reflect that whatever reported in the financial statement is a normal affairs or a normal situation for same type of company. So that's why we will have to identify if there is any abnormalities or any unusual activities or figure reported in the company's financial statement. So for example, your business might own a single parcel of land. If you sold that land, the gain from the sale would go on your income statement and would increase your profit for the year. But the land sale would be one time event. You won't be selling more land in the years to come, so that gain isn't repeatable and your profit for the year is abnormally high. So this is another example lah on what aspect do we need to do financial statement normalization. So in this example, it is stated that if your company sold a piece of land which is owned by the company, and then normally, as it is mentioned here, when you sold your land, the company's land, the proceed or the gain or the income from selling those lands will be reported in the company's income statement. So as a result, for that particular year, your income statement would be higher than your normal year whereby you do not sell any of your land. So in this example, because of the selling, you sell your company's land during that year, and since it is reported in your income statement, so you will end up that your income or your net profit for that particular year is slightly higher compared to your normal years. So this aspect should be normalized. So your income statement for that particular year need to be normalized. So it is stated here, on a normalized income statement, you would remove the land sale. So in this example, when we do normalization, or when we normalizing our income statement, we would take out the proceed or the profit or the gain, the income from the land sale activities from the income statement, because the land sale activities for that particular year is unusual or a non-recurring activities or item. So when we take out the amount of profit or gains from the land sale activities, so our income statement will become a normal. So that's why we need to do some normalizing on our financial statements. So when we talk about normalizing a financial statement, it could be our balance sheet or it could be our income statement. So, but if you look at the nature of the financial statements, most of the time, the type of financial statement which is frequently involved in the normalization process is income statement, because normally income statement is used to report your income, your expenses for your businesses. So that's why if you look at most of the example for the financial statement normalization, most of the example will use or will refer to income statement rather than balance sheet. But having said that, please bear in mind, in some cases, balance sheet will also need to be normalized. But most of the time, the normalization will involve income statement. So, only items that would remain on the statement would be the revenues and expenses directly related to the normal operations for your business. So this is the explanation or the purpose lah, the purpose of normalizing income statement. So once we have taken out the gain, the profit, the income from the land sale activities, so that the company's income statement will become normal, because as I mentioned just now lah, normally what income statement will report is only revenues and expenses for the company. So if there is some abnormal or unusual or non-recurring items, we may need to do normalization. So when you are doing your assignment, so you should look at this type of activities from your income before you decide whether or not your income statement need to be normalized. So what you need to look at is there any abnormal, or is there any unusual, or is there any non-recurring income which has been reported in your income statement? If there is any, then only you need to do normalization on your income statement. If there are no unusual or non-recurring items reported in your income statement or in your balance sheet, then you don't need to do normalization on your income statement. So the keywords in deciding whether or not to do normalization on your income statement is look at if there is any unusual or non-recurrent items or activities reported in your financial statement. So as I mentioned lah, when we are talking about financial statement, normally we will refer to balance sheet. Balance sheet, again, it is also known as statement of financial position. Some companies, when they are reporting their financial statements in the company's annual report, they don't put it as balance sheet. They put it as statement of financial position. So please bear in mind lah, whether they call it balance sheet or statement of financial position, is it is the same financial statement. So normally in the company's annual report, they will include balance sheet or statement of financial statement and income statement. So far, do you have any question to ask before we proceed to the next slide? Anybody want to ask anything?
How about the renter received from the property, but the main business is doing the transportation logistics?
It depends. If the renter received is a recurring items, but it is appear in the company's income statement every year, then you don't need to normalize them.
Okay.
You will only need normalize them if it is non-recurrent, and meaning that it only appear once in every 5 or 10 years. So if it is only appear once in a while, meaning that it is non-recurrent. But if it is appear every year on yearly basis, meaning that it is a usual or recurring items. So if it is a recurring item, you don't need to normalize them.
Okay, mother. Thank you, sir.
So this is the purpose of normalization. So the normalization creates a presentation of the entity's financial performance in a what if scenario of optimal or normal operation. So if it is abnormal, then you need to normalize to make it normal. Let's say for instance, what you asked just now, if the rental is part of the company's normal income or normal operation, normal activities, then you don't need to normalize. Useful for comparing to similar entities in similar industries. So that's why we need to do normalization in order for us to compare the financial statements for our subject company with our comparable within the same industries. So bear in mind, remember, because when we are doing a business valuation, we may choose any one of the available approach. So the available approach that can be used in order to value a business is income approach, asset approach, and market approach. Normally, whatever approach you choose to be used in order to value a company, still you cannot run from the element of comparison. Let's say if you doing the income approach, you still need to compare the income between your subject company with the comparable companies within the same industries. So that's why we need to normalizing, or we need to perform the normalization activities on the company's financial statement. So another purpose of normalization is normalization would be useful for benchmarking the entity against industry standards. Useful for calculations of value for purchase or sales purposes, as well as obtaining investment or debt capital. So normally apart from business evaluation, the normalization process will also involve in the process of investment. So if let's say a client seeking for advice from investment consultant, so when the investment consultant advise the client, so they will also do the financial statement normalization in giving advice to the client. Because normally when an investment consultant advise the client, they will need to present some evidence, some comparables from the market. So in order to convince the investors, normally the investment consultant need to normalize the financial statements for the company that they used in their analysis. So, but now since we are talking about business valuation, so we are discussing the purpose of normalization or the purpose of normalizing financial statements from the business valuation point of view. So to the financial statements are made for a variety of reasons. If the company is seeking external funding, so again, this is the function lah, the use of normalizing financial statement or financial statement normalization. So when selling the business, a potential buyer will want to see the normalized statements as whether the business has been profitable overall or not. So when adjusting the financial statement, you should only remove discretionary expenses and one-time gains or expenses. So again lah, Lee Guan, this is the keywords lah. Discretionary expenses, one-time gains or expenses. So if we refer to your question, if the rental receive or the rental spend is one-time gains, then you need to normalize them. If it is a normal or if it is part of the normal business income or expenses, then you don't need to normalize them. So it is mentioned here lah, you should only remove discretionary expenses and one-time gains or expenses that are unrepresentative of normal operating expenses. So the reason why we normalize the statement is to make sure that whatever we get from the financial statement is their normal operating income or operating expenses. Here are some examples of normalizing adjustment. So this is the example lah. So this is one of the example that you could do normalizations on. So what the first one is owner's salary and expenses. Siapa baru join kelas tu? Teng. Nazri, baru balik dari Bendang apa? Dah 40 minit baru nak join. So this is the one, the first items or criteria that you may need to normalize from your financial statement. So owner's salary and expenses. In most private companies, the owner have discretion over the amount of salaries and allowances that they draw from the company accounts. Also, the owners may decide to pay their personal expenses through the company account. Such expenditure may include travel allowances, internet costs, entertainment, vehicle, fuel, etc., etc. This cost reduces the net revenue of the company. When selling the company, appraisers or evaluator must add back these expenses to the company's earning. Do you understand what is this slide trying to explain?
Understand.
If you understand, it's because it is very straightforward, right? So the next element or the next item that you may need to normalize is rental expenses or rental income. This is what you just asked, Lee Guan. Tadi kan, you tanya kan? A company may decide to pay rent that is above or below market rate when the company premises are owned by the company or a holding company, adjusting the rental expense to reflect the prevailing market value will help normalize the financial statements. Also, where the company earns a rental income from its properties that does not constitute a part of the company's core business operation, this income should be eliminated. But now, if you look at the current trend now, some company do invest in real estate under corporate real estate. So if the company has a corporate real estate as part of their portfolio, part of their activities, or part of their operation, so the income from those real estate or properties under corporate estate can be included in the financial statement. It depends on the nature of real estate or the companies in the companies. It depends on the nature of real estate or property in the company's business activity or the company's investment portfolio. If it is clearly that the real estate or property is part of the company's corporate real estate, then it may be included as part of the normal income for the company. But if it is not officially part of the company's corporate estate, and then it has to be eliminated. So if we refer back to Lee Guan's question just now, as I mentioned, if the income from the property or from the real estate, it come from the property or real estate which is under corporate real estate owned by the company, and then it may be included in the financial statement. So if it is part of the normal activities, normal income for the business, you don't need to eliminate, you don't need to do normalizing activities. But if it is not part of the normal activities for the company, then you need to eliminate, you need to normalize them from your financial statement. Because if you look at the trend nowadays, it is a common trend that especially for a corporate, a big company, apart from their normal business activities, they also involve or they also invest in real estate under the term corporate real estate. So if it is part of the company's corporate real estate, and then the real estate or property generate income, normally it will be reported in the company's financial statement, and therefore we should not eliminate, we should not normalize them, because it is considered part of the company's business activities, even though it is not the main business activities. Like for instance, kan, if you look at Aeon Big, if you look at My Date, if you look at Jekyll, their main business is not real estate. Like Jekyll, they are selling apa ni, kan, textile. Maiden, they are selling household punya apa ni. But they do also invest in real estate, because the reason why they also invest in real estate as part of their business strategy is to reduce expenses. By owning their own properties, they can save from paying rent to the other parties. But if you look at most of the company like Aeon Big, like Maidin, like Jekyll, for the property that they own, they also rent it out to their tenants. So in that sense, the property or the real estate also generate income to the company. So normally they will report the income from the real estate sector in the company's financial statement. As long as the activities is not abnormal activities, if it is part of the company's business and that it occur or it appear in the financial statement every year, then we may not need to do a rental expense or income normalization on the company's financial statement. Because this is the keyword. If the renter from the properties does not constitute a part of the company's core business operation, but as far as the corporate real estate is concerned, if the company do involve in corporate real estate, then it will become part of the core business of the company. Because one of the reason why a companies or a corporate involved in the real estate is to diversify their activities, to diversify their source of income for the business. Because if we look at the theory of investment nowadays, everybody is aware that property is one of the business or a type of investment which can secure the company's survival or company's income in a long term. So that's why if you look at most of the company nowadays, they do involve in the corporate real estate. So if you look at the definition of corporate real estate, you have study kan corporate real estate subject, right? Have you taken corporate real estate subject?
Yeah.
Last sem kan with Dr. Aino?
Yes.
What is the definition of corporate real estate? What is corporate real estate? Ryan, what is corporate real estate, Ryan? Susan, what is corporate real estate?
Study about company, how they utilize the space.
Ya ke? General definition about corporate real estate, study about how company utilize space.
In order to help their business, how they use their real estate to help their business.
Real estate space.
I think real estate is about corporate real estate.
For operational purposes.
Dia invest in real estate kan, dia use real estate. What does a company actually do when they do involve in corporate real estate? What did actually they do when they do involve in corporate real estate? Are they investing or are they buying the real estate, or are they just renting and managing the real estate?
Utilizing.
You know, utilizing. You rent, but you can utilize the real estate. That's what I am asking. What actually is a corporate real estate? Yeah, the definition the corporate real estate ni.
Business, which meant business is not about the property one, not about real estate one.
Apa liguan you cakap kalau you tulis dalam exam macam tu, you fail tau. Apa corporate real estate is about big one. Normally what corporate real estate is a company which is not involved in real estate or a company whereby real estate is not their their core business involved in real estate. Itu yang saya bagi contoh tadi, Jekyll, Maidin semua tu. Jekyll, Maidin, their core business is not real estate, but they do invest, they do involve in real estate as a part of their company's investment or business strategy. So itulah basically what is a corporate real estate is all about. But if you are talking about REITs, REITs dia punya investment portfolio is not their corporate real estate, because REITs is meant for investing in income producing real estate. So as far as a REITs company is concerned, we don't call the property owned by REITs company is a their corporate real estate. Faham tak? Takkan Dr. Aino tak ajar definition dia, atau you dah lupa, atau you buat-buat lupa, atau you don't understand what is a corporate real estate is all about. Kalau if you look at by the definition, corporate real estate ini a non real estate, a non real estate business or a non real estate companies involved in real estate business or real estate activities. Betul tak, AK? AK ada ke tak ada ini?
Ada, sir.
Hari ni saya nak lupa nak ambil gambar untuk attendance sekarang lah. Saya Nazri pun baru masuk kan, nanti tiap kali muka dia tak ada dalam attendance, susah pula. Betul tak, AK? What is a corporate real estate is all about from your understanding?
Yes, sir. Yes, my understanding. Yes. From my understanding...
Yes, tu jawab. Yes, tu jawapan paling selamat. Budak tarika pun boleh jawab yes.
Okay, sir. No, sir. No, no.
Huh?
My answer is no. From my understanding, corporate real estate is just like a property manager, but property manager punya kerja is just one property. But corporate real estate, dia jaga whatever property yang company tu own.
Boleh jawab. Tak payah. Tapi ke praktikal ini, feel kerja semua orang ni. Boleh tak feel kerja semua orang? Ha? Semua orang nak feel je ni. Corporate estate pun tak tahu apa ni. Ikuan, apa itu corporate estate, Ikuan?
Okay. From my understanding, corporate real estate ni dia a business enterprise yang
bukan... Janganlah berbisik, Wan. Kita bukan berdua je dalam kelas ni, ramai lagi. Ada 37 orang, 36 yang lain cepat cakap tu. Kuat sikit. Tak dengar.
Basically, business company yang bukan major dalam real estate ni, dia macam own a real estate for its operational purposes. Contohnya macam McDonald ke kan, dia own a kedai restaurant for its operational purposes. Macam tu ke?
Setuju kan, Nazri? Hai Nazri, setuju tak?
Tahu
lah. Tahu lah jawapan dalam exam tu, dia tak tahu lah, sir. Saya pun tahu, bagi tahu lah markah kau, Nazri, kosong. Afiq, what is the corporate real estate? Afiq tak ada hari ni. Ini Brian tak aktif macam selalu, Brian.
Yes, satu.
Hari ni you lupa makan ubat ke, atau you tak breakfast pagi ni? You tak macam tak energetik macam selalu. Selalu kalau kelas Brian mesti ada soalan, Brian mesti ada cakap. Hari ni kenapa Brian lemah saja?
Biasa saja.
Apa tak payah jawab. Tak payah jawablah Brian. saya saja saja. Kenapa hari ni you lemah saja? So this is a rental income lah macam tu. Nanti you carilah apa itu corporate real estate balik apa semua tu. Kan? Kalau you dah belajar what is corporate real estate tapi you tak tahu corporate real estate tu betul lah kalau macam AK cakap tadi tu, kalau kalau you tengok di overseas, dia 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 ada tau degree in corporate real estate, dia 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 jadikan corporate real estate tu sebagai profession. Tapi kalau you tengok apa yang you belajar dengan Dr. Aino in in your corporate real estate subject tu, it's not meant by the the corporate real estate profession tu ataupun corporate real estate course tu. So what you learn in 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 your corporate real estate subject tu apa? Maksudnya dia dia it, what 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 you have been taught in corporate real estate subject tu, what is the the purpose of 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 real estate for a, a non real estate companies. Yang termasuklah macam yang tadi siapa cakap, the company use, how the company manage, how the company apa ni property tu, because they are not mainly real estate investors or real estate operator, tapi dia dia do involve in 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 real estate. Kalau you pergi tengok balik dia punya definition of a corporate real estate tu, kalau you tengok mengapa why why a company a non real estate company do involve in real estate. Kalau macam if you look at Petronas, Petronas is non real non real estate company. Their core business is a petroleum kan. But why they do involve in 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 real estate macam KLCC semua tu? So what what where is the 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 real estate punya position in 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 their company? Because core business. So the third element that may need to be normalized is non-recurring expenses or income. So under non-recurring expenses or income ni, we will look at we will look for abnormal events that are unrelated to the company's core business. Ini for instance, for example, selling land activities lah, which has been discussed before kan. The company's sold land in that particular year. So for the for that particular year's income statement, we need to normalizing the income statement, because gains or income or profit from the property selling or land selling activities is not the company's normal activities. So therefore we need to normalize that particular year's income statement to make the income statement normal. So that's what it means by non-recurring expense or income. So another example is maybe during that specific year a company buy or invest in a building. So whatever cost which is reported as expenses in that particular year's income statement need to be normalized, because the expenses that the company spend for acquiring a property is abnormal or non-recurring expense. It will only appear in that particular year's income statement only. So because if we do not normalize the income statement for that particular year, it will affect the company's net profit, because any expenses which is spent and reported during that particular year will reduce or may affect the company's net profit or net loss. So therefore, if we find out that during a specific year's income statement, we find out that there is non-recurring expenses or income reported, then we need to normalize that year punya income statement, get normal events or normal income for the property. So the under non-recurring expense or income may include building renovation, gains or loss on asset disposal, insurance payout, lawsuits and sale of the company land. So this is an example lah. But this example is not only limited to whatever stated here. So when you are doing a business evaluation, when it comes to the normalization of financial statement, you need to be very careful. You need to be alert on the types of income or expenses reported in the financial statements. So in order to identify or to detect any anomalies or abnormal events reported in the financial statements, you need to study what is the company's core business, core activities. So if you know the company's core business and core activities, then maybe it is quite easy for you to decide whether whatever reported in the income statement or balance sheet is abnormal or not, as far as the company is concerned. So that's why I'm not sure whether you are aware or not. If when you are doing a business valuation, in the engagement letter, normally we will state that the process will be based on due diligence. What does due diligence means? Nanti we will look at lah what is due diligence. What are the type of due diligence? So as far as the business evaluation is concerned, the process will be done on the basis of or based on the due diligence. So the fourth element or items which may need to be normalized is extraordinary events. So extraordinary events refer to unusual gains or loss that materially affect the company's finance. Also, an event is classified as extraordinary if it is not part of the day-to-day operation of the company. These events may be comprised of materials, storm damage, regulatory or tax ruling, lawsuits, costs of implementing a new production system, restructuring costs, sales of assets, etc., etc. So if you look at extraordinary event and the non-recurring, it may overlap and between non-recurring and extraordinary event. Because if you look at some of the detailed example, some of the items may be considered under non-recurring. So this is example lah of extraordinary events. New production system, restructuring costs, sales of assets. Just now under non-recurring pun, there is a sales of asset kan, purchase of asset. So you need to be very careful lah. Items or elements that need to be normalized. So normally you can detect, you can determine the types of items or events which need to be normalized from your financial statements. So by looking at your balance sheet and income statement, you can decide whether you need to do normalization on your financial statement or not. So this is sekejap dah lari sikit even. So this is one time events and versus extraordinary events. These events should be treated differently in the financial statements. The one time or non-recurring items should be recorded under operating expenses in the income statement, while the extraordinary items should be recorded after the net income figure. The management should provide an additional explanation to these events in the management discussion and analysis. So this is the differences between one-time event or non-recurrent. Dan dia panggil apa tadi? Non-recurring events and extraordinary events. So for non-recurring, it will be reported under operating expenses, while for extraordinary, it will be reported or recorded after the net income figure. So by looking at the company's financial statement, i.e. balance sheet and income statement, then you may aware lah what type of events reported in the income statement, whether it is one time or extraordinary. So as it is mentioned here, one time will appear under expenses, operating expenses. Extraordinary will appear after the net income figure. Dari pula ni. So look at this. Let's look at this. Apalah dia lari-lari lah. Why normalizing adjustment are essential? So is the this is the reason lah why normalizing adjustment are essential as far as a business valuation is concerned. Financial statements are not particularly meaningful without a relevant basis of comparison. There are two types of benchmarks that a company's financials can be compared to: its own historical performance and the performance of other comparable businesses. So this is why when we do the topic on the analysis, this is what we call vertical and horizontal analysis. Vertical and horizontal analysis, whereby you do the analysis using your own company's past or historical financial statement, and you do comparison between your company and your competitors within the same industries. So you may need to refer this under vertical and horizontal financial analysis. What does the vertical horizontal analysis means? What does vertical? The vertical and horizontal analysis. Before you conduct a benchmarking study, however, it is important to make normalizing adjustment to avoid any misleading comparisons. So this is the main purpose, like as I mentioned, why do we need to normalize the financial statement? The answer is to make sure that we get the normal performance of the company under normal circumstances. Because if there is some abnormalities or any abnormal activities which happen in certain years, therefore, we need to normalize. We need to take it out from the financial statements to make it a comparable. So again, this is the explanation on the non-recurring items. Yeah, kita dah explain above accounting norms. Other normalizing adjustment compensate for the use of different accounting methods because accounting practices vary widely. So you may also need to find out, whether the financial statement is prepared according to which standards. In accounting, financial reporting, we have GAAPs, generally accepted accounting. GAAPs, generally accepted accounting procedures ke apa ke, dia ada GAAPs, dia ada macam-macam lah. Under Malaysian Accounting Reporting System, there are International Accounting Reporting System. So when you are doing your business relation, you may need to ask the management, you may need to ask the accounts manager which standards they are using in preparing their financial statements. Are they using GAAPs ke, Malaysian Accounting Reporting System ke? So you need to find out lah, because there are some differences between all those guidelines or all those reporting system. So normally if you are valuing a local company, so most of the time they will use the local accounting standards in preparing the financial reporting. But the problem is if you are valuing an international company, so for the international company, they may not use the local accounting reporting standard. Maybe they will use the international accounting reporting standards. So that is the duty, the responsibility of the valuator to find out which standards that the company use in reporting their financial data or in preparing their financial reporting system. So this is a related party transaction. Another type of normalizing adjustment focus on closely held businesses. They often pay owners based on the company's cash flow or the owner's personal need, not on the market value of the services the owners provide. So this is the, if there is a we can call it ini kita panggil apa, conflict of interest. So if there is a related party transaction or conflict of interest in the business activities, then we may need to identify that and normalizing from our financial statement. So before we look at an example of balance sheet and income statement normalization, do you have any question to ask? We will look at a simple balance sheet and income statement adjustment. Before we proceed, do you have any question to ask? Hello, anybody home?
Tak ada,
okay. Sekejap, saya nak kena pergi menari sekejap, sakit tekak. For your assignment, have you guys started looking at the are you guys started looking at normalizing your financial statement because I was told that some of you have started looking at these normalization of funds for your assignment. So again, like as I mentioned last week, if you want to make it simple and easy as far as your assignment is concerned, don't choose a complicated company. Choose a small company. But of course, lah, you need to find a company which may involve normalizing the financial statements, because it is a good exercise for you. But if you choose a complicated or more complex company, then the normalizing process will become more difficult. But if you choose a simple company, so the normalizing adjustment process will be as simple as possible lah. What is important is you know the concept of financial statement normalizing, normalization. What is the purpose of the financial statement normalization? Because normally when you present your assignment later on, maybe the panel will ask you, why do you need to normalize your financial statements? Is there any difference if you do not normalize them? What is the major difference between you normalize and not normalize your financial statement? What is the impact on the value of the company? So you should prepare to answer such questions during your presentation, because as I mentioned repeatedly, the main purpose of your assessment, either it is test, assignment or final examination, is to test your understanding on the subject. So that's why when I ask you about the corporate real estate, though, if you do not if you can't answer it, I'm not sure whether the subject has met the course learning objective or not. But right, so, if you have taken the,
like our company, right? If we compare
Liguan ke Brian ni?
Brian.
Brian suara macam Liguan. Saya sudah beralih kepada Liguan. Sebab Liguan sekarang sudah banyak tanya compare dengan Brian. So saya sudah benci Brian.
My question is, for our company, right? If we compare among years, there's no non-recurring item. So, how about if we doesn't take any working for the normalization? Is it okay? Since there's no.
This is question for your group. This is question for your group assignment, right? I won't answer it here.
Okay.
Because the dangerous side, if I ask your questions here, and then it may affect your other friends' understand on the general concept of normalizations. Because you see, the normalizations for your financial statements will be based more on the case-to-case basis. It depends on what items or what events appear in your company's financial statement during the year that you are referring to. Because yes, when we do a lecture on these normalizations, when we only give a general or a standard guidelines on how to do normalizations. What is the criteria that you need to look at to decide the financial statements for your company for certain years need to be normalized or not? So, but when you decide whether to normalize or not, it will be based on case to case basis. So we will need to strictly refer to the financial statements which is involved in the process of your evaluation too. So in that sense, as I mentioned just now, I won't be able to to answer your questions in a general format. So we need to thoroughly look at the financial statement. Then we need to decide whether to do normalization or not. If we decided to do normalization, so what type of normalization that we need to do? What is the criteria? What is the event? What is the item which cause us to normalize the financial statement? And then the about the financial statement, is it balance sheet or is it income statement? You need to thoroughly look at the elements of normalizations from your financial statement. So whatever listed in this slide is a general principles, general rules and regulation on the normalization. So for a specific, you need to look at the company's punya annual report or company's punya financial statement to decide. So yang itu nanti, if you want advice on your itu tu, we will discuss later lah with your group. We are not going to discuss about your group assignment here, because here we are talking about a general principle, general guidelines on the financial statement normalizations. Okay, Brian.
Okay,
right.
Thank you,
Sazu. Because I don't want to answer your questions. So this is a balance sheet normalizations. Again, like as I mentioned, normally in a normal practice, most of the time normalizations process ni would frequently involve income statement, but sometimes it's also involve a balance sheet. So non-operating or other asset retained by sellers, this is the elements or items which may need normalizations from your balance sheet. So under your for your balance sheet, so this is the item that may need to be normalized. Non-operating or other asset retained by seller, excess cash which would not go with a sale, impaired or non-performing equipment, inventory, account receivable, goodwill or investment in another entity, non-GAAP presentation, incorrect booking of an asset when it should be an expense or cost, a reclassification of debt to equity. So this is the example of items for balance sheet which may need to be normalized. So this is the potential normalizing adjustment for income statement. Incorrectly presented gross margin, tax depreciation, depletion used for presentation rather than gap for that industry. So tengok balik lah, what is gap? Unusual costs or expenses due to outside factors. This is again lah under, we have gone through just now under unrecurring ataupun tadi apa, unrecurring or extraordinary events. So this is items lah, either under non-recurring or extraordinary event which you may need to look into from your income statement. Expedited freight due to short working capital impeding delivery, higher than normal borrowing cost such as PO financing, financing or factoring, large account receivable write off due to major customer bankruptcy. So this is other types of normalizations. The first two slide is strictly from balance sheet and income statement. So this is other normalization that we may need to do or to consider. Comparability adjustments. Compare a company does not present financial statement in accordance with industry norms. So this is what I said just now. You need to find out when preparing the financial statements, which financial standards that the company use. Is it the local financial standards or the international standards? Because sometimes they might be a slightly difference between the local financial reporting system and the international standard financial reporting system. So as a evaluator, a person who do the evaluation for the company, we need to find out. So if there are any differences between the financial reporting system used by the company and the financial reporting system used by their competitors or the comparables within the industry. So if there is any differences, we may need also to normalize between these two financial reporting system. So that is the due diligence of the evaluator lah, of the as I mentioned lah, for business relation, we don't call the person who do the business relation is a valuer, because accountant and legal practice can also do the business relation. So that's why we call it a valuator. So executive may be paid above or below norms for that industry. And then we need to identify whether the payment or any benefits paid to the executive is at par with the industries or above or below the industry. So if there is differences between the benefits paid to the executive between the companies and the industry, we may need to normalize. Let's say bonus, let's say average in the company, average in the industries pay the managers 6 month bonus, 6 month salary bonus, but your company, the company that you are valuing, is pay 10 months bonus. So you need to find out why there is a discrepancy, why there is a differences between the average industries and your company. So if there is a difference, then you need to normalize between your companies and the average from the industries. So sometimes it has happened in the industries. Let's say the normal bonus rate paid by the average in the industry is 6 months, but for some reason your company paid your managers 8 months. So why is it happens? So you need to normalize lah if it is happen between your company and your competitors within the industries, higher or lower than market rate. Yeah.
Does this mean that for other three comparable company we choose, we also need to do the normalization for these three companies?
It depends. Sometimes if you find out that the abnormalities happen in your company, then you just need to normalize your company. But if the anomalies, if the abnormalities happen in one of the comparison, meaning that your company and the other two comparison is similar, but one of the comparison of the comparable has some abnormal item, then you may need to normalize that particular comparables only. It depends. But most of the time, most of the time, we will find out, we will get a similar comparables from the industries. But most of the time, the one that we need to normalize will be our own subject company. But there is also a situation whereby we need to normalize your either one of your comparables. Let's say it is very difficult for you to find comparables in the industry. Then you find, you manage to get three comparables. Let's say out of the three comparables, two is similar to your company. However, the other one is very strange, different from your company. So maybe you may need to normalize the comparison to look at the trend within the same industries. Kan? After doing the normalization, then maybe you find out that the figure is more or less same. Then it is okay lah. But most of the time, we do normalization on our subject company. Because as far as the comparison, the comparable is concerned, we will try our best to get the three comparables to similar lah between each other. So if the three comparables similar but they are different from other company, so we need to normalize our own company. Boleh, Susan?
Okay.
It happened in the industry. In industry, the situation could be more complicated. It's not like as easy as when we do lecture in class. Because when we do lecture in class, what we give you as example is a simple example, and we will just explain you the concept, the principles on how normalizations will be done on the either balance sheet or income statement. What is the situation which force you to do normalization? But when it comes to the real life case, you need to scrutinize, you need to look at the case thoroughly to decide whether first you need to do normalization or not, and then if you do need to normalization, what type of normalization that you need to do. Is it from the balance sheet or the income statement? So if it is from the income statement, is it under unrecurring activities ke, extraordinary activities ke? So you need to study first lah the companies and the comparable financial statement before you can decide. So this is the relevant time frame for you guys to do the analysis. As far as normalization is concerned, so normally it will be 5 years. As I mentioned last time lah, normally on average for the analysis we will go back for the 3 years period. But if you find out that during that years recession happens, blah 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 blah, you may need to expand the analysis to 5-7 years. But in normal, usually we will do analysis based on the past 3 years performance. So this is a simple case studies lah to show how normalizations is done on the balance sheet and income statement for this company. Strange Code Software Incorporated, software development company, has two majority shareholders. One is the CEO and the other one is non-participating, is a inactive lah. So for this company, for this example company, it is a software development company that it has two major shareholders, which is the company CEO and one which is not participating in the business operating or business management. So wishes to obtain a working capital line from a bank, has never had one before. Financial statements are recorded in QuickBooks. So the purpose of this for this simple case study is the company's intended to obtain a financial loan from a bank. So therefore they need to prepare this normalization of financial statements to be submitted to the bank or financial institution. So this is the company's asset as reported in the SOFP, statement of financial position. So this is in this example, they use the past 3 years record or analysis, which is 2010, 2012, and 2011. So this is the under current asset. This is the type of current asset which the company has for 2010, 2011, and 2012. So this is the total current asset, and then this is the fixed asset owned by the company. So by looking at this SOFP or balance sheet, so we can see that there is a huge difference between savings reported for 2010, 2011, and 2012. 2010, the company has 306,134. 2011, 155,367, and 2012 only 34,000. So for account receivables, in 2010, the company reported that the account receivable, the amount of account receivable is just over 100,000. In 2011, is almost 300,000. And then in 2012, it escalate to more than 400,000. So this is a type of abnormalities which you may need to look into from your financial statement. So as far as this example is concerned, now we are looking at the company's balance sheet or statement of financial position. So we need to look for any abnormal items or abnormal activities which is reported in the company's financial statement. So the one that we are looking at now is the company's balance sheet. So for the company's balance sheet, now we are only looking at the assets part only. We are not looking at the liabilities and owner equities part. We are now referring to the company's assets from the company's SOFP or statement of financial position. So we need to study lah the amount for the three different years, and then later on we may decide whether or not to to do normalization. Look at the fixed asset for office equipment. 2010, it is reported more than 18,000 worth of office equipment for the company. Whereas for 2011 and 2012, the amount is just slightly above 1,000. So if you look at between 11 and 12, the figure is quite similar. But when we compare 2010, it is a huge difference in time in term of the value of office equipment reported in the company's balance sheet or statement of financial position. So therefore we need to investigate why does it happen, why does the company reported a huge amount of office equipment in 2010, but in 2012 and 2011, the amount decreased drastically from 18,000 to only above 1,000. So we need to investigate. Then maybe we need to normalize this element. Look at the fixture and furniture. So the amounts reported in the 3 years balance sheet is the same amount, 16,440 for the all 3 years. So we may not need to do anything for fixtures and fitting because the figure shows dia kata standard trend, normal trend. So look at accumulated depreciation. So for 2010, the accumulated depreciation reported is 30,000. In 2011, 14,000, and 2012, 15,000. So this is the amount of net fixed asset. So this is amount for other asset. So as far as the total asset is concerned, the amount is quite similar lah. For the amount of total asset, 2010 we have 424, 2011 we have 454. 2012 we have 466. The only abnormal figures that we can detect from this balance sheet is for checking savings and for office equipment.
Sir Zhu. It's a bit small for the slide. We can't see clearly.
Am I purposely don't want you to see clearly? Because if you can see clearly, you don't ask. If you can see it clearly, you don't ask. But if you can't, then you will ask. Can you see it clearly now?
Yes. Thank you, Sir Zhu.
Sir, for the office equipment or like the example show in the slide or. In 2010, big compared to 2011 and 2012. Then,
if what?
Then we still need to do the normalization, even though it is a very big figure.
That's what I am talking about. Because just now, the only abnormal figure. Reported for this 3 years balance sheet for this company is checking savings and office equipment. So look at the checking saving and also account receivable. Checking saving for 2010 above 300,000, but for 2011 is 150,000, and in 2012 is only 34,000. So we need to check why there is such a huge difference between these 3 years checking savings amount reported in the financial statement. So we need to investigate lah. From the investigation, later we may decide whether we need to normalize or not this element. Even though there is a huge difference here, you cannot straight away say that we need to normalize them. We need to investigate first. What caused the huge difference between these 3 years balance sheet? We need to investigate first. Same with account receivable. Okay. If you look at 2010, above 100,000. Then 2011, it increased to almost 300,000. 2012 is more than 400,000. So the trend is increasing. So we may need to check with the industries. What is the trend? for account receivable within the same industries? Does it shows the same trend or only these companies is showing this type of trend as far as checking savings and account receivable is concerned? Again, for office equipment, I did mention just now, kan? If you look at 2010, the amount reported here is 18,000, almost 19 lah, 18,593. Whereas for 2011 and 2012, the amount is below 2,000. So there is a huge difference between 2011-12 and 2010. So in this context, we may need to further investigate, and then most likely we need to normalize the amount of office equipment for this company. So before you decide whether or not to normalize, we need to investigate first what caused the situation. So the rest is about the same. So this is liabilities reported in the income, in the balance sheet or statement of financial position. So this is the liabilities and then the owner equity. So normalization, stockholder debt is considered equity. So reclass all to equity in the paid-up capital, paid-in capital. So look at this. Dia kata apa tadi? Stockholder debt is considered equity. Look at the stockholder debt. What is the amount of stockholder debt? Mana stockholder debt? Payable stockholder. Stockholder. Inilah. Look at the amount here and then you need to decide whether to normalize or not. Accrued stakeholder interest due book to current liabilities, so reclass. Interest paid on the debts reclassified from interest expense to dividend. No effect on EBITDA but does increase net income. So EBITDA is earning before interest, tax, depreciation and amortization but does increase the net income. No adjustment or asset or depreciation. Depreciation was tax basis, but difference last 3 years is very minor. So will not have material impact. So look at the asset depreciation. So it is reported that the differences between the for the depreciation is not a huge difference. So no need to do normalizations. So this is example income statement normalization. So we need to look at the income statement first and then decide what type of normalization that we need to do based on this income statement. So again, the companies reported the past 3 years, the 3 years income statement. So this is the income, 2010 more than 2 million, 2011 and 2012 is just about close to 2 million. The gross profit, so this is the amount reported. And then we need to scrutinize, we need to study this figure which is reported here, and then we need to decide type of normalization that we need to do. So from the example, it is stated here gross margin not calculated properly, vital for industry benchmarking. So if we find out that the gross margin is not calculated properly, then we need to do normalization on the gross margin. Operation, sales and admin salaries all in one line item. So look at. So by right, operation, sales and admin salaries will not, should not be reported that way. So this is the normalized balance sheet. This is the original balance sheet as reported. Mana tadi? Alamak. So look at what item has been normalized. So here you look at the amount for other current asset. So previously it is reported that only 2011 the company has 12,800 value of other current asset, but after normalizing the reported balance sheet, so we came out with this figure. For 2010 is 2722, 2011 62. Where do we get the amount from, this figure from? So when we do the normalizing, the normalization, we need to refer to the industries. So we need to look at the company's detail. So what type of other current asset reported in this 3 years balance sheet, and then how do we normalize them? Where do we get this figure from? So this is the total current asset after we have normalized the financial statements. So as far as this balance sheet is concerned, normalizing activities or adjustment involve the items that they put in bold. So as far as this statement of financial position is concerned, we only do normalizing adjustment on other current asset. So the rest we do not do anything. This is maybe due to the fact that after checking with the industries, so there is no issues for the other items, but only issues with the current asset, other current asset. So that's why we only normalize other current asset. So this is the liabilities. So after normalizing the liabilities for these companies, so we came out with this figure. So we normalize account payables for 2011 and 2012 only. For 2010, we do not normalize them, but it is the same figure. So again, we also normalize working line credit. So in order for you guys to understand this example, you need to go through this example and then look at the explanation, which we do not have much time to do now. I will upload this slide after this, and then maybe you need to spend some time to go through, and then if you have any questions, you can ask me you can ask me in the group, and then we will discuss about this normalization of income statement and balance sheet. As mentioned in the slide, this is a simple example, kan? In the real life scenario, real case scenario, you may find a more complicated case. So you need to use your discretion on doing the normalizing on the financial state. This is a 10 questions which can help to provide an overview of the concept of income statement. So in normalizing income statement, this is among the questions that we may want to ask ourselves, are there any discretionary items of income or expense that should be adjusted for in the valuation analysis? Are adjustments appropriate based on inventory policy? Are adjustment appropriate based on depreciation policy? So before you decide whether normalize each items under income statement, you need
I got one question here. So like for in account, right, it's it's charged in dual side, which means like if increment in asset, it also maybe got increment in liability. But when we do normalization, maybe they only list out like in the asset side, there's they purchase plant and machinery. But how we gonna know that which account we should deduct, like the opposite account? Because if we just deduct one side only, the account will be imbalanced.
As far as the normalizing is concerned, we are normalizing their end product, their financial statements. We are not going to touch on their single account. Do you understand how do the company get the figure which is reported in their financial statements? So the figures which they reported in their financial statements, whether it is balance sheet or income statement, is the final figure, the closing amount for each of the individual account during the financial year. So what we are doing here when we normalizing the balance sheet or income statement, we are not touching on their account per se. We are just adjusting the final figure which is reported in their balance sheet and income statement as we compare to the competitors within the same industries. So therefore, we are not going to ask ourselves if we normalize, let's say, element of income in the company's income statement. We are not going to burden ourselves to think, oh, what will happen to the company's account? Will it be balanced if we modify the figure in the income statement? That is not the issue. As far as the normalization process is concerned, we are only looking at the end product. We are looking at the financial amount, the figure which is reported in the company's financial statement. So we will compare the company's financial statement with the average in the industries to look at whether it is any differences or discrepancy between between what is reported in the company's financial statement and what is reported by other companies within the same industry. So if there is a huge difference, then only we do the normalization. So I'm not sure why you have to think about when you normalize the amount whether the company's account will be balanced or not. It's not a question of the company's account balance or not, because the whole process is involved. We as a valuator adjusting or amending the reported amount in the company's financial statement to eliminate, to take out any abnormal activities, item or figures which is reported in the financial statement. So we are not concerned about the company's individual account, whether it will be balanced or not after we adjust the amount. Faham tak, Susan? The process of normalization involve a process of we analyze the company's performance based on what is being reported in the financial statement, just to find out whether what is being reported by the company is a normal situation for the same company, for the other company within the same industry. So if we find out that what is being reported by the company in their financial statement is different from what is produced by other company within the same industry, then only we will do the normalization. Normalization is just to detect any abnormal activities for the company. Because when we are doing valuation, when we are comparing between the subject company with the comparable, we have to make sure that the criteria or the element that we are comparing with is the same ataupun similar punya criteria or elements. That's why the whole process of normalization is all about kita nak find out if the company has reported any abnormal activities or amount or figure or items in their financial report or financial statement. If we find out there is abnormal activities, then we need to adjust, we need to normalize that activities to make that the company punya financial statement tu is as normal as other company within the same industry. Itu dia punya proses. We are not thinking about, oh, kalau aku ubah ni apa akan jadi dekat company ni punya account, ya, balance ke tak balance. Because actually the accounting process is also has been done, kan? Because we are comparing the past 3 years punya performance. So we should not take into consideration at all whether after we have amended or normalizing the figure from the income statement or balance sheet ni, will the company's account balance or not. Pasal benda tu dah lepas. Of course lah, when the company's prepare the financial statement, their account is balanced. That's why they report the amount in their apa ni tu. You ada kelas lain kan lepas ni? Nanti lecturer lain marah nanti. Tak apa. I will upload this slide. Then you spend your time to go through later on. And then if you need extra session to further explain this one, we can arrange lah later on. But next week we cannot do it lah. Because during the lecture and tutorial slot next week, Dr. Zai will take over from me. So you find out first, look at the slide. If you feel that you need some, maybe we can arrange half an hour or 1 hour session to just go through back this whole concept of normalization. So because it is almost 10 past 11, but I don't want you to be late for other class. Okay, Susan. So after we end our session now, I will upload this slide. Then maybe you will need a few days to go through the slide, then try to understand the whole concept. So if you feel or things that you still do not understand, then maybe we can arrange sessions for me to explain again the concept to you guys, because this normalization concept is important in business relation, and then it will differ case by case basis. It depends on how complicated is your company, how complicated is your financial statements. The more complicated financial statements prepared by the company, is more a complete normalization process that you have to do. So, but from the prinsip from the theory perspective, that is what you need to know about normalization. What is the definition? What is the purpose? How can we perform or do normalization on our financial statements? But on the specific items, it may differ between companies to companies, between different financial years, different industries. So it is the task of to decide and to determine which item need to be normalized. Why it need to be normalized? Dia macam tu lah. So for as far as your business relationship is concerned, your group members need to decide lah whether you need to normalize your financial statement or not. If you decided you need to normalize, what aspect need to be normalized and why? Okay, I think we will end our session now. So you.